joy and gladness again. Keep me near, I'm desperate for you. Lord, I know what you must think of me. Let me show I'm desperate for you. Betrayed,
thank you. brought forth before the earth was born, from generation to generation, you are God. Before the mountains were brought forth, understand your power. With the praise of angels, sing to you all my days. We will shout your holy name. The whole earth sings, you are God. We will shout your praise of angels, sing to you all my days. We will shout your holy name. The whole earth sings, you are God. You're the same for a thousand years. You never change. You're the God over all.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. when death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested,
so glad that you're with us. Thank you for joining us. I hope you've had a good week. I hope you've enjoyed the little bit of sunshine that we've had there, here and there between the showers. And yeah, we just hope you're well. It was lovely to see so many of you in church last Sunday, and to just be able to worship together was really special. So we're really glad you were there, and we will be back there very soon. Watch out for information coming on that. I hope you're good. I hope you've had a good week. Kids, I hope school has been okay. And parents and other adults, I hope that you've had a good week at work. And yeah, isn't it lovely that stuff's slowly returning to normal? And yeah, let's just hope that and pray that this continues in the way that it's going. It's really good, isn't it? We have had some lovely news this week that we thought you would love to hear. If you haven't already, then where have you been? This week we have a new addition to our church family, and in particular the Kanyes have an addition to their family. Beautiful baby Zanelli Poppy was born this week, so congratulations, Sarah. She is a beautiful £9.6, and so well done, Sarah and Wells. And Daisy's a big sister, which we just can't wait to see come to fruition, and for Daisy to just be carrying Zanelli round. So please pass on your congratulations to them. Remember them in your prayers as they adjust to life as a family of four and get used to all that that involves. But such lovely news, isn't it? Great to be family together and be able to celebrate beautiful things like that. So well done, Kanye family. We are so pleased for you, and we can't wait to have snuggles and to get Zanelli into church, which hopefully won't take too long. So we are going to start our service. We have worship coming up first from Bethan and the team. So, get ready to join in. There is no limit on the volume you can sing at when you sing at home. So I want to be able to hear you from my house. Go and have a good sing and blow away the cobwebs and just put everything else down and worship our God.
Made us new, now life begins with you. Oh Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou art, that my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my life. Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true word, I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son.
Riches I need not, no man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, thou and always, thou and thou only, the first in my heart.
Oh, high King of heaven, when battle is done, grant heaven's joy to me, bright heaven's sun. Christ of thy own heart, whatever before,
call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, runs deep, my faith will stand. I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters, the sovereign failed, and you won't stop now. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of
good just to be able to worship and take a deep breath and put down what we've carried through the week and just worship God together in that way. So thank you so much. Next, guys, we're gonna have Sue. Kids, are you listening? adults are you listening? Because we know that Sue speaks directly to the adults and the kids as well. Hope you're ready. Kids, put down whatever you've been playing with or making a noise with during worship and listen, because Sue might have some questions for you to answer. Take it away, Sue.
Children, it's Sue again, and I've got Tommy with me today. Give him a wave. He's very excited about being on the video again. Years ago, I used to have a bracelet, and on it, it said WWJD. And you know, I looked everywhere for that bracelet this week. I couldn't find it anywhere. I wonder if any of you know what WWJD stands for. Well, it stands for What Would Jesus Do? Now, I looked everywhere for that bracelet, and then I rang Anne up and asked Anne if she had one I could borrow for the video. And guess what she did? What do you think she did? You don't know, do you? She made me a bracelet. Look, WWJD. Isn't she clever? And she's so kind and so loving. And guess what, kids? Those are Jesus's characteristics as well. He's loving and kind. And that made me think of the fruits of the Spirit. Do you remember 2 weeks ago, Lucy spoke about the fruits of the Spirit, and we've done it in Kids Church, haven't we, about the fruits of the Spirit? I wonder if any of you can remember what they are. Can you remember? Well, I'm going to remind you. Okay, so the fruits of the Spirit are the same as Jesus's characteristics, and they are love, joy, you're going to look over the top, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are the fruits of the Spirit. And that is Jesus's characters as well. He's very loving, isn't he? And he's gentle. And all those things describe Jesus. Do you know what? Think of the coolest person at school, the coolest person in your playground. Not the coolest person because he's the naughtiest person. No, the coolest person because he likes, people like him. He's got something about him that he's, he loves people. He likes things to be right. He likes justice. He likes peace. He's just a nice person to be around. And guess what, kids? Guess what? Jesus was an amazing person to be around. And he still is, because he's so full of those fruits of the Spirit. And when we're in the playground or playing out or at home, those are the things that we need to be showing other people. And when we're faced with a situation that we don't know what to do and we're doubting or we're tempted to do something that we shouldn't do, like bullying somebody or not being nice to somebody, we have to remember, what would Jesus do? Would he do something like that? No. Jesus is loving and kind and all the things that you like in another person. Let's pray together. Put your head down and then pray. Father God, I thank you that we can talk about you and that you love us and that you teach us how to be like you. Help us when we're in a sticky situation or when we're not sure what to do. to think about you and think, what would Jesus do? Father God, bless us as we go into this next week. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Okay then, I'll see you next time. I'm going to say goodbye. Goodbye. Have a nice week.
Thank you so much, Sue. That was brilliant. And as always, something for the adults to take away as well as the kids. So kids, I hope you were listening, but adults, I hope you were too. We were in this house. So thank you so much. We really appreciate all your time and effort in amongst everything else that you do, Sue, to put that together for us every week that we're online. Now we're going to continue in our new series that we're looking at. We're looking at the life and times of Jesus. We're looking at different attributes of his character and different things that he did over these coming months. So it's going to be an exciting series, and hopefully by the end of it, each week we'll slowly build on our knowledge and appreciation and understanding of all that Jesus was and is and can still be for us. So we are going to dive into the Word now to cover that new topic, and Wynn is going to speak to us from the life of Jesus.
Thank you, Lucy, and good morning, everyone. Lovely to be with you. Lovely to be on your TV screens or your computer screen or wherever you are at the moment. So great to have you with us, and my thanks to everybody who's participated in this service so far. Thank you. Wasn't it great to be together again last Sunday in our building, and we look forward to doing that more often in the future. We'll be together again next Sunday. Don't forget to sign up on our Facebook group page. Look for the Eventbrite page there. You've done it before, but you need to do that for next Sunday. And that'll be going up, if it hasn't done already, it'll be going up very soon, sometime today, later on today. So get signed up for that, please. And, last Sunday, I introduced and I launched our next series of talks, the focus of which is Jesus. And I spoke to you about his uniqueness and gave you some biblical and extra biblical evidence for his existence. And most historians, I said, and most theologians and ordinary everyday thinking people like you and me, we now believe that Jesus was a real and historical person who lived 2,000 years ago in Israel. There are bigger questions that we'll be dealing with over the coming weeks, like the resurrection of Jesus and is he really the Son of God? And last week I asked the question, who is this Jesus? Because I think it's true to say that we all want to know him better than we do. But today I want to try and answer another question. What do we know of the character of Jesus? Or I'll put it another way, what was he really like? If I'd met him on the shores of the Sea of Galilee while I'm walking through the streets of Nazareth or Capernaum or Jerusalem and I'd met him, what would I have thought of him? What impression would he have made on me? What would it have been like? You know, you meet some people, don't you? And you know full well that I wouldn't want to cross you. I wouldn't want to get on the wrong side of you. You certainly don't take prisoners. And then we meet others that we are drawn to. And we know that they could become good friends. We know we could talk to them about anything without any sort of condemnation coming from them. And then there's others that we meet that we just think, well, yeah, take it or leave it, indifferent, you know? That's how things are. But I wonder what feeling within us would have been generated if we had the opportunity to meet Jesus face to face 2,000 years ago. Maybe our experience would have not been all that different from the experience we had when we first became Christians and started to walk with Jesus and get to know him through in that way. However many months or years that was. One thing I think we can almost guarantee is that Jesus wouldn't be predictable. There were several people who spoke to Jesus expecting a certain answer, but they got something else. What I mean is that some people went to Jesus expecting a pat on the back, but instead they got a very strong reprimand. And others went to him fearing the worst, but they found him very comforting and understanding and supportive. He even saved the life of one person who was on her way to being lynched. But what sort of person? What sort of person was Jesus? What can we glean from the Gospels about this man's character? And it is really only from the Gospels that we can get any information, because history books don't tell us anything. We don't even know what he looked like. I mean, there are one or two ancient churches, apparently, that have very old drawings and paintings that were done in the 1st and 2nd century AD of Jesus. But they don't really tell us anything. So we're completely dependent on the Bible. And even the Bible doesn't tell us what he looked like. So we don't know if he was tall or he was short or he was of medium build. We just don't know. We can be pretty certain that he was bearded, and that's about all we can say. But it's not really important, is it? Because what we want to know really is what the character of Jesus was like and how that affects you and me in the here and now, today. Well, I think there can be no doubt at all that one of the things that really motivated Jesus was compassion. Whoever they were, the young, the old, the rich, the poor, the influential, the powerful, or the beggar in the street, Jesus had time for people. He always looked upon them, had compassion for them. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 38. Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 38. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Let me take you to another passage in Luke chapter 7. Verses 11 to 15. Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. And as he approached the town, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the town was with her. And when the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her. And he said, "Don't cry." Then he went up and touched the bier. They were carrying him on, and the bearers stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." And the dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. You see, Jesus had compassion on those who were sick, those who were diseased, those with mental health problems, those who were devoid of meaning and purpose in their lives, those who were struggling to make ends meet and were just about able to feed their families, had to scrape and save to pay for the taxes and the rent of their property. And on top of that, they lived in continual fear of the cruel Roman occupation of their country, and the very people who should have looked after them, their religious leaders, only made life more difficult for them by creating many, many rules and laws that made life hard and complicated. But Jesus had compassion on them. Jesus had compassion on them. Think for a word, for a moment of that word, compassion. It means more than just feeling pity and sorrow for someone. Having compassion for a person or a group of people means feeling sorry for them. It means having pity on them, but then it necessitates doing something about their plight. When Jesus saw the crowds and had compassion on them, he instructs his disciples to pray for more workers to be sent out into this harvest field. So he does something. When Jesus sees the widow's dead son being carried out on a bier, his heart went out to her and he has compassion on her and says, "Don't cry." But then he does something and he raises the young man from the dead and gives him back to his mother. What was Jesus really like? Well, he was a man whose heart went out to the lost, the last and the least. Isn't that amazing? That the creator of all that there is, the ruler of the universe's heart, went out to this woman. You know, at present, when we see the news on TV or we read the newspapers, we feel sorrow for the people of India who are suffering from this pandemic, where people are just lying on the streets and dying there. We feel pity for those who are suffering and can't breathe, for whom there are no hospital beds or oxygen or respirators. We feel intense sorrow when we hear that they're having to cremate so many bodies. They are creating funeral pyres in car parks, and the government have given permission for bodies to be burned on the streets because there's just no room in the crematoriums any longer. And the government have also given permission for trees to be cut down in Delhi so they can use them to burn the bodies in their funeral pyres. There are just so many dying. And we may look at these scenes and tut tut and say how awful and how sad and feel intense sorrow and pity, but compassion involves doing something about it. And I think we may have uncovered a way in which we can exercise real compassion and do something about it through this connection we're developing with a network of hospitals across India. We are at the moment gathering information all the time, but how we can give to this Emmanuel Hospital Association, which is a Christian network of hospitals, who say that any money we give to them will be given directly to hospitals working in the neediest areas. Keep your eye on our Facebook group page. Over the next few days, we will be giving more information about there, how you can give into that fund if you wish to. Certainly, LDC will be giving a lump sum from its coffers, and you will be invited as well to give something personally to that if you wish to. I'm also hoping that we can extend this fund giving to other churches in Harrogate and maybe elsewhere as well. Let's see how things work out. Very recently, we talked about reaching out from Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth, and maybe for the time being India is our ends of the earth. So one thing we can say about the character of Jesus Christ is that he was a man filled with compassion, so much compassion indeed that he went to the cross for us. Whenever he was anywhere near people, he understood what their real needs were and try to address them. For many, it was physical healing that was needed, but for others, the underlying need was spiritual. But in all cases, we read about Jesus never being dismissive of people. He actively noticed that they were hurting, that they were troubled, that they needed him, they were distressed in some way or other, and his compassion led him to help them. If I'd met Jesus in the street in Capernaum, or Nazareth, what my impressions of him have been? I think another characteristic that would have stood out was his gentleness. That, of course, didn't make him a soft touch or a pushover, because there were times when he spoke very directly and used quite powerful language. For instance, when he called the scribes and the Pharisees a nest of vipers, a brood of baby snakes, that was quite strong language. But there were times when he had to be direct with difficult people, and other times when he knew he needed to be gentle. It's interesting, isn't it, that the children came to him, and I can imagine them climbing onto him and sitting on his knee and listening to him talk and him listening to them chatter. And he made sure his disciples knew better than to stop them from doing so. We've already seen that when he spoke to a widow who had lost her only son, he was gentle with her. He told her not to cry. He did the same with several people who were upset, distraught, frightened. One of the loveliest and most powerful examples of this was when the mob, the lynch mob, brought before Jesus a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. Now, when you stop to really think about what she'd done, it was a terrible thing, a terrible sin that she had committed. She'd broken her marriage vows. She'd cheated on her husband with another man, knowing that the penalty for that in this culture was death. Let's be honest about it. It was no small sin that she had committed. Even in the 21st century, even in our anything goes culture, we still get shocked when people commit adultery or acts of infidelity. But Jesus calmly told the lynch mob that the person who had never sinned should be the first to throw a stone. And the mob dispersed. They just evaporated. And in John chapter 8, verse 10, Jesus says to the woman, "Where are those who condemned you?" "They've gone," she replied. "And neither do I condemn you," And people like to say that Jesus just let her off. He ignored her sin, but that's not true. Because you see, he very clearly told her then to stop living this life of sin. He was gentle, but he was direct. I think that something else about Jesus would really make a strong impression on me if I met him, and that is his wisdom, this extraordinary wisdom. Would be obvious when you listened to his teaching. People actually commented a few times when they heard him speak, asking where did he get this authority from? Where did this wisdom come from to preach and teach like that? They'd never heard any of their leaders speak like this man with such wisdom and authority. And when the Pharisees and the scribes and the priests tried to lay a trap for him by asking him a question, which by answering would have condemned him, every time they tried to trap him and get him into hot water, he exercised this remarkable wisdom and turned the tables on them. Should we pay taxes to Caesar or not, they asked him, knowing that if he said yes, or if he said no, he'd be accused of terrorism and rebellion. And if he said yes, you should pay him, he'd have been seen as a traitor. So he answers, it's Caesar's head on the coins. So give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God. You remember the other traps they set from by planting a man with a withered hand in the synagogue to see if Jesus would heal him on the Sabbath, something they banned because they saw healing as the same as working, and working was banned on the Sabbath day. So Jesus simply asks, what's the right thing to do? To do good or to do bad? To save life or to kill? And the wisdom of Jesus wins yet again. I'm pretty sure that if you and I spent any time sitting there in Capernaum or Nazareth or another town or city, watching Jesus interact with those around him, we would be very impressed by his wisdom. And interestingly, that same wisdom is available to you and me. Where did the wisdom come from? Well, Jesus spells out very clearly in John chapter 5, verse 19, where he says, I can only do what I see the Father doing. And then, and further on in chapter 12 of John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 50, Jesus says, whatever I say is just what the Father's told me to say. And clearly, that same wisdom is available for you and for me as well, because it's from the same source. It comes from the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is within us if we believe and we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Saviour. That same Holy Spirit is within us, giving us the same wisdom that he gave to Jesus. So what was this Jesus really like? Now, I can see through reading the scriptures that Jesus was humble. He was humble. He was referred to as a rabbi. That was quite honorific. Teacher, and his teaching was unlike anything that people had heard before. Thousands of people would sit on the seashore and as he spoke to them from a fishing boat. Or a multitude of people would sit around a mountaintop or a grassy area where he not only taught them but afterwards fed them, 5,000 of them, on a few loaves and a couple of fish. Wicked, self-seeking, money-grabbing people like Matthew and Zacchaeus were transformed in a matter of moments by just sitting in his presence and listening to him teach about his heavenly Father and the kingdom of God. A woman who had many husbands in the past, another one who lived a life of extreme immorality, Mary Magdalene, and innumerable others had life-changing experiences through just being close to him, listening to him talk, and knowing they were loved in a way that they'd never been loved before. He had every opportunity and right to feel proud and demand praise and recognition and accolades after what he'd done. We don't know how many sick people he healed. We don't know how many lepers he prayed for to be cleansed, but we know that there were many. It says in Mark chapter 1, verse 32, just after Jesus had healed Peter's mother-in-law, that the whole town gathered at their door for him to pray for the sick and the demon-possessed. People watched him heal sick people that were lowered through roofs on their stretchers or in the synagogue, the like of which they'd never seen before. And Jesus always remained humble. Jesus always remained humble. Even when the crowds tried to make him their king, he broke free from their grasp. We've already mentioned the raising of the widow of Nain's son and the raising of Jairus' daughter from the dead. We've also have to remember the raising of Lazarus from the tomb after he'd been dead there for 3 days. And yet, after all these things that he'd done, he said, I haven't come to be served, but come to serve. The one who should have been treated like royalty, because that's what he is, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But instead, he rolled up his sleeves and he did the work of a servant and washed his disciples' filthy feet, because none of them would lower themselves to do such a menial task. Another of Jesus' qualities that define his character was his honesty. We've already said he was gentle, he was humble, he was compassionate. He'd come to serve, but he also told the truth. He was honest. He didn't mince his words when it came to telling people what would happen to them if they didn't repent, if they didn't turn from their evil ways. He talked about people being cast out into the outer darkness, where they'd be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth if they didn't change their ways. You know, as Christians and as evangelists, Christian evangelists, we seem to have drifted towards a salvation theology that only focuses on the blessings of becoming a Christian. We tell people how good it is to know God through Jesus, that we have such a great life, that we have answered prayer, we'll be filled with the Holy Spirit, that someone with us, we've got someone with us who will always be with us, never leave us, never forsake us, and bring rest to those of us who are weary and heavy laden. And at the end of it all, we will live eternally with God in heaven, all of which is perfectly true. But we don't give them the other side of the story, which is, if we don't repent, if we don't give our lives to Christ, if we don't submit to him, if we don't ask him to come and live within us, then we could be hellbound. You know, Jesus was honest enough to tell the truth, as unpalatable as it was. But he told them the truth not to bring them under condemnation, not to threaten them, but to rescue them. This is an area that needs careful and very sensitive and wise handling, because I have few occasions I've heard of Christians telling people their behaviour, their lifestyle would mean that they're hellbound. Now that's not, it's not we who decide who is going to heaven or hell, but God. The decision is his, not ours. So we need to be careful what we say and how we say it to other people. But at the same time, we need to be honest and truthful, as was Jesus. So what else in Jesus' character drew so many people to him? The gospel tells us that he called his disciples to follow him as they mended their nets and as they worked in a tax collector's booth. And they dropped whatever they were doing. They just dropped whatever they were doing. And they followed him. There were others during those years of Jesus' ministry who were ready to leave everything and follow him. A Gadarene demoniac, a rich young ruler, several women, probably dozens more. The crowds gathered in their thousands to follow him and sit at his feet as he spoke to them. What did these men and women see in him that caused them to give up everything to follow this man? Well, in addition to the things I've already mentioned, I think they saw a man who was full of the most unusual love. Unusual because it was the love of God. It was a divine love. Never had they come across a man before who loved like this and who made them want to love in the same way. What I wonder happened, really happened in the house of Zacchaeus that day when having a meal with Jesus, Zacchaeus is suddenly constrained to give away most of his wealth to those he's cheated and to the poor. I just think he must have been wonderfully overwhelmed by the love that he saw pouring out of this man. And it was so refreshing for him. It was so pleasant, so different to meet someone who wasn't out for whatever he could get, who wasn't self-centered, who wasn't self-seeking, but just wanted to give of himself as a servant in a sacrificial way. And Zacchaeus not only wanted more of this love, but wanted to love others himself in the same way. You could say that Zacchaeus saw another trait in Jesus' character, that being forgiveness. Now, Zacchaeus had lived a wicked, selfish, corrupt life where he cheated people out of their hard-earned cash as he collected taxes for the Romans. He was seen as a traitor by his fellow countrymen, and that resulted in hatred from everyone. No doubt Zacchaeus had dealt with this by hardening his heart to everyone. And at the same time, he continued to line his pockets. Everyone hated him. Nobody wanted to be associated with this man. And more certainly, no one could forgive him for what he'd done to them. Until he met this one man, this one exceptional person, the first person other than another tax collector, the first person to come and eat with him in his house. And he experienced such forgiveness at that moment, forgiven by the one who a few weeks later was praying, "Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing," as Roman soldiers nailed him to the cross. And the forgiveness he displayed throughout his life was leading people towards that ultimate forgiveness that people would receive when they eventually turned to God and received Christ as their Lord and Saviour. What other worthy and noble character traits would we find within Jesus? Well, we've already said that Jesus was gentle, he was loving, he was forgiving, he was compassionate, and so much more. Right at the end of John's Gospel, he says, Jesus did many other things as well. If everything, every one of them was written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have enough room for the books that would be written. And you know, I think we could say something very similar about the different character traits of Jesus. How can we talk about what it would be like to be with one who is perfection himself? The one who is God. There are traits within the character of Jesus that are beyond our understanding and beyond our ability to describe them because they are divine, because they come from God. But over the last 25 minutes or so, I've looked at the following obvious character traits that you'll find in Jesus, those being compassion and gentleness and wisdom and humility, servant-hearted, honest, loving and forgiving. And I want to say to you that as well as appreciating those traits within Jesus, we should also be cultivating them within ourselves so that you and I are becoming more compassionate, so that we're becoming wiser, becoming more gentle, exercising greater humility, learning to serve others, being lovingly honest and forgiving others. And I hope and I pray that this morning we not only learned a little more of what Jesus is like, but also learned something of what we should be like as well. Thank you for listening. I really hope and pray that has been helpful, that's encouraged you, built you up, blessed you, just done you good as we try and discover a little bit more about who this Jesus really is. God bless you. Have a great day. Thank you very much.
Well, that's it for this week. Thank you everybody that's contributed. Thank you, Wynn. Thank you, Sue. And thank you to Bethan and the worship team. It's a lovely morning. And although we can't be together, this is a really good way of doing church while we can't be together week in, week out just yet. So thank you so much for everyone that's contributed. If you would like to give to the work that we do as a church, then please follow the link on the page and you'll find all the information you need to give financially to the work that we do. We would really appreciate that if you're able to. But that's it for this week. We hope you have a great rest of your week. Watch out for information about our next in-person service because you'll need to book a ticket just so that we know that we've got the right numbers of people and we can safely socially distance and get everything sorted for your arrival and get kids packs and everything ready. So watch out for information on that on our next service. And can I just pray for us before we go? We would do this at the end of our service normally, so let's do it now here online. Father God, we thank you for this time that we've had together. We thank you for the people that have contributed, for the time and the energy and the effort that takes to do that and to get it online. Lord, I thank you for each and every person that is watching, that has taken the time to watch either live this morning or later in the day or later in the week, Lord. Whenever they're watching it, Father, I pray that you will bless them, that you'll fill them with your Holy Spirit, Lord, that you'll strengthen them where they need strengthening, that you'll give them peace where they need peace, and that you will be everything to them that they need at this time. Father, would you run alongside each and every one of us as we navigate this next week? Would you draw close to us and just help us to know your presence, to be so close? And Lord, we lift up particularly the Kanye family. We pray that you will help them as they grow as a family of four. We pray that you will help them all just to adjust and for them to thoroughly enjoy these early days with their new addition. And we pray, Father, that you will help Zanelli to fall in love with you the same way that her parents and big sister have, and that she will grow up to know you and to be just a mighty woman of God who knows your hand on her life from before she was born right through the whole of her life, Lord, we pray. We ask for your blessing over them and your blessing over every single person in Life Destiny Church and those watching online as well. Be with us, Father, we pray, for your glory, to bring glory to you and to point others towards you through the way we do things and the way that we conduct ourselves because of your presence being with us, Lord. We ask all these things in your name, for your glory. Amen. Have a great rest of your week, and we shall see you again very soon.